So on behalf of Peace Alliance Winnipeg, the organizer of this meeting, I'd like to welcome all of you to what is going to be, I'm sure, a very informative evening with Yves Engler. And before I introduce Yves, I'm just going to take a few minutes to explain what some of the things that are happening this week. So this meeting tonight is to introduce Yves Engler's new book. But also this on this Friday evening at the Hotel Fort Garry at 7 p.m., there is a meeting being organized to discuss the current situation in Venezuela, and in particular, the events that are going on there and what is behind what is going on in Venezuela. The meeting is titled, What is Really Happening in Venezuela? It is a public forum at the Hotel Fort Garry this Friday evening from 7 to 10 p.m. The two speakers will be Steve Elner. He's a professor of economic history at the Universidad de Oriente in Puerto La Cruz, Venezuela. American, but he has taught for years in Venezuela. He is currently on tour to explain the effect of sanctions that Canada and the US have levied on Venezuela and the effects that they're having on the people there. He will be joined via Skype by Carlos Ron, Vice Minister of the Venezuelan Ministry of External Affairs for North America. So it is an important meeting for people to begin to hear some real facts about Venezuela, because part of the problem in Canada is those facts aren't being discussed. And if you just go by what the main media discusses about Venezuela, it's a very stilted picture. It is very much anti the current Venezuelan government and very pro the opposition forces in Venezuela. So we think it's important for people to come and hear two real experts, I would say, on the question of Venezuela, and for theirs to make up their own minds about what the truth is and what's going on there. And I think it's very important because Canada is taking the lead in attacking Venezuela. And right now it's in the form of sanctions. But it is really doing the heavy lifting for the U.S. on this question with various other Latin American countries. And Canada has imposed these sanctions without on the basis of, on behalf of all Canadians, in a sense. Whether we agree with them or not, it's imposed them. So it's important for people to understand this element of Canadian foreign policy and what's behind it. And I think that's a natural introduction to Yves. And Yves Engler, as author and journalist, has done extensive work to really expose the various myths behind Canadian foreign policy in various books and what Canada is really up to in the world. So I think it's very good that we have people such as Yves in Canada who are doing such work, because it's much needed, and it's much needed to explain what's really going on in Canada. We have his book for sale at the table over there, as well as some of his earlier books are there as well. And we have two sign-up sheets for if you're interested in doing being involved on the work of Venezuela. There's an organization called the Venezuela Peace Committee of Winnipeg, and it has been meeting since last fall, and it specifically got together because of concerns about how the issue of Venezuela was being dealt with in Canada. And there's also a sign-up sheet for the Peace Alliance Winnipeg if you want to stay in touch. And just lastly, while this is a free meeting, if anybody would like to contribute to help defray the costs, there's a basket there which you can do so. So again, back to Yves Engler. Yves will speak for about 10 to 15 minutes or so on his book. 50? 50. He'll speak for about 50 minutes about the content of his book. I thought that was short. He'll speak for about 50 minutes. There'll be a question and answer period, and then he will be available to sign the book. So I'd like to, Yves has been a regular guest in Winnipeg around his books. Peace Alliance Winnipeg has always been pleased to host him, and we are again pleased to host him. So without anything further from me, please welcome Yves Engler.
Thanks for that. Thanks for the Peace Alliance for putting this on. Thanks everyone for coming out when you had the opportunity to have the first day of legalized bud, and you decided to come out to listen to this. That's very impressive. So this is a tour from my latest book, Left Right, Marching to the Beat of Imperial Canada, which is a very underwhelming book because it's only trying to answer 10% of a question, which is why do Canadians overwhelmingly believe this country is a force for good in the world, even when our foreign policy is overwhelmingly designed to advance corporate interests and to advance empire, historically British, Canadian, American. The 90% of the answer is contained in my previous book, A Propaganda System, How Canada's Government, Corporations, Media, and Academia Sell War and Exploitation. This book, Left Right, was initially conceived as part of Propaganda System, and what it's trying to argue, or what it shows, I would like to believe, is how left institutions have gone along with the dominant narrative of Canadian foreign policy. They haven't been a counter to the primary system of propaganda that the Propaganda System book looks at: the dominant media, the military, which is the biggest public relations entity in the country, the academic institutions that are funded by leading mining magnates, etc., etc. That's the most of the explanation is contained in that. But this is just looking at the left element of that. And so the book begins with a chapter on the NDP-CCF foreign policy and how the NDP and CCF has gone along with Canadian foreign policy. So, for instance, the CCF supported the creation of NATO. Right? NATO was the tool of bringing the colonial world under the U.S.-led geopolitical umbrella, bringing the former colonies under U.S. Influence. CCF supported the war in Korea. Right? They immediately supported sending Canadian naval vessels and then actually pushed the government to send ground troops. The CCF has a long history of anti-Palestinianism, right? Supporting Canada's role in dispossessing Palestinians. So, for instance, after Israel conquered Jerusalem, David Lewis, a longtime top official within the party, called for a united Jerusalem under Israel's aegis. When the Palestinian Liberation Organization was admitted as an observer to the UN in 1974, there was a UN conference that was supposed to take place in Toronto the next year, and Stephen Lewis, who was then the head of the Ontario NDP, called for that UN conference, which had nothing to do with Palestine, to not take place in Toronto because PLO representatives may attend the conference, right? Or fast forward until today, and Hélène Lavalliere, the NDP's foreign critic, in 2016, she goes down to APEC to speak at the main Israel lobby group organization in the U.S. at their conference. Or when Hélène Lavalliere was in Israel, she participated in a Jewish National Fund event. Jewish National Fund is a colonial institution that's explicitly racist, right? It has essentially racist land covenants, policies that were made illegal in our country 70 years ago. That's what the JNF, what the JNF is about, and you have the NDP foreign critic participating in that. And you find that while the NDP has started to criticize some Israeli policy, you find that there's almost no criticism of substantial elements of Canada's role in Palestinian dispossession. So, for instance, the NDP says nothing about the fact that there are hundreds of millions of dollars raised in tax-deductible charitable donations this country sent to Israel. Israel's GDP is on par with Italy or Spain, right? Much of that money goes to supporting racist organizations in Israel, goes to supporting the Israeli military, goes to supporting legal settlements, right? And the NDP refuses to in any way ever challenge those policies. So the NDP, it's a bit more complicated than just a singular anti-Palestinian perspective like it was at one point today, but NDP continues to be quite clearly anti-Palestinian. Switching gears to this hemisphere, Venezuela. The NDP has very much in the past few years supported the campaign to undermine and potentially overthrow the Maduro government. And that campaign includes sanctions, three rounds of Canadian sanctions. You have Donald Trump a year ago or so talking about a foreign invasion of Venezuela. You have the head of the Organization of American States just a few weeks ago talking about potential for a foreign invasion of Venezuela. Then you have many Republican top Republican figures in the U.S. calling for a coup in Venezuela. Nothing from our government criticizing that, but nothing even from from the NDP, right? While you have Chrystia Freeland, our foreign minister, basically being an activist on this issue, where she's going to Caribbean countries that Canada has a lot of leverage over and prodding them to join the so-called Lima group of anti-Palestinian governments. Nothing, not a word from the NDP people. There's not a word about foreign invasion, not a word about potential coup, not a word about Canadian sanctions. And it's actually worse than that. Lavadière has actually been prodding, going back to 2013, from the right on this issue. So in 2013, she criticized the Harper government for being too soft on Venezuela. In 2016, she put out a press release bemoaning, quote, the erosion of democracy, and saying that Ottawa needed to, quote, defend democracy in Venezuela. In 2017, Lavadière, in front of a parliamentary committee meeting, said that Venezuela's vice president was a, quote, a drug lord for whom, quote, the American government has seized billions of dollars of his assets for drug trafficking. This is the extreme fringe of the right in Venezuela that Lavadière is puppeting before our parliamentary committee foreign affairs. So on Venezuela, the NDP has very much aligned with this campaign to destabilize the elected government. Militarism is another area the NDP has very much gone along with. So, for instance, in 2011, when NATO bombed Libya, the NDP supported two different House of Commons votes in favor of the bombing of Libya. At the time, Jack Layton said, quote, it's appropriate for Canada to be a part of this effort to try to stop Gaddafi from attacking his citizens as he has been threatening to do. Then after Gaddafi was killed, Nicole Turmel, who was the interim leader at the time, said, quote, the future of Libya now belongs to all Libyans. Our troops have done a wonderful job in Libya over the past few months. Of course, Canada's troops, as the word she uses, in Libya, any ground troops were contravening UN Resolution 1973. Of course, the bombing campaign in Libya contravened the UN Resolution, which said to have a no-fly zone to protect the civilians. It didn't say bomb in favor of regime change. Not to mention a whole other series of ways in which Canada violated the UN resolution. And look at Libya today. I mean, it was wrong at the time. I opposed it at the time, and many people opposed at the time. It was clearly wrong at the time. But the facts 7 years later are it's a catastrophe. Libya is a catastrophe. Totally divided, warring factions. It's destabilized much of the Sahel region of the African continent. And this is exactly, of course, I go into this in my Canada and Africa book. The African Union said exactly this. We oppose this. What's going to be the result? And obviously that was ignored. So militarism is an area that the NDP has very much had a problem with or has aligned with Canadian militarism. And many examples that I detail in the book. One striking recent example is in June of 2017, the Liberal government called for, put out a defense policy statement calling for a 70% increase in military spending over the next 10 years. It included increasing Canadian special forces. Those are the special forces that are involved in all kinds of nighttime assassination raids in Afghanistan, all kinds of other dubious affairs. It called for a offensive cyber capacities, and it called for purchasing armed drones, among another, a series of other more sort of offensive endeavors. Randall Garrison, the NDP foreign critic, response was to say, to complain that not enough of the 70% funding increase took place immediately. Too much of it was down the road, right? We want increased military spending right away. So militarism is an area that the NDP has very much endorsed official policy. The second section of the book deals with labor unions and the ways how labor unions engage with the rest of the world and particularly Canadian foreign policy. And for the most part, Canadian labor unions at this point, at least the sort of the broad progressive end of the labor movement, they're no longer active supporters of Canadian imperialism. They were for a long time. I think that kind of got broken down by the anti-war movements of the late 60s, some of the Central South Africa solidarity movements of the 70s and 80s. But for the most part, they don't engage with Canadian foreign policy. They don't engage with foreign policy. And a stark example of that was a supplement, a 14-page supplement in the Toronto Star during the Labor Day weekend this year, so 6 weeks ago. And in that 14-page supplement, which was paid for by the Ontario Federation of Labor, and it had a number of the affiliates of the OFL had produced their own stories and had ads and stuff like that, there was about 10 words that dealt with the rest of the world. So I should back up a second. This was really the labor movement presenting the most progressive face of unions. So this was talking about how unions fight racism, fight for LGBTQ rights, in favor of indigenous rights, calling for farmer care, calling for better workplace standards. This wasn't unions just, being about protecting members, but this was a bit more sort of class-based kind of unionism. But in this supplement that was presenting the most progressive end of the labor movement, like I said, 10 words about the rest of the world. And those 10 words were to do with a legislation in New Zealand where people victimized by domestic abuse could have a certain number of days off when they're victimized. So even when they talked about climate change, they didn't even talk about the rest of the world in this OFL. And I think that really encapsulates the labor movement's the thrust of the labor movement's position on the rest of the world. Now in the book. There's a long history, of course, until the 70s, and it's a little bit some recent, of the labor movement supporting Canadian imperialism. So one of the things I did in researching the book was to read the journal of the Trades and Labor Congress, going back to the start of the 1900s. Trades and Labor Congress was one of the predecessors to the Canadian Labor Congress. And its journal, the Canadian Congress Journal, all kinds of stories that really very much aligned with Canadian foreign policy. But a couple that I dealt with in the Caribbean, I think, were pretty stark from in the late 1920s. They very much endorsed Canada's corporate power in the Caribbean. So one story talked about, in a very positive light, Canadian trading, quote, Canadian trading and financial interests have become well established throughout the islands. Well, of course, this is during British colonial rule in the Caribbean, right? So nothing about British colonial rule. And Canadian banks they're referring to have become, at that point, were very powerful in the Caribbean and continue to be very powerful in the Caribbean. But that's a very contentious issue. That's been a very contentious issue in the Caribbean. Another one of their articles about Canada's role in the Caribbean said, quote, "For well over 100 years, Nova Scotia and New Brunswick traders and sailors established contact with the islands, bringing Canadian fish and produce in exchange for fruits, sugars, and other products. So this, when they talk about Canadian Canada bringing fish to the Caribbean, what they're referring to is the Atlantic provinces selling cod to the slave plantations, right? That's the relationship between Atlantic provinces and the Caribbean. It begins, well, begins earlier than that, but is significant in late 1700s, early 1800s. And basically what that was the Caribbean slave owners didn't want to devote any of their land to producing foodstuff for the slaves, right? But they needed a high protein source of cheap fuel for the slaves to keep them working 16 hours a day. And that fuel was cod, the lesser cod, the refuse fish from the Atlantic cod. The better cod went to Europe, and the rest went to the Caribbean slave plantation colonies. So this is what the Canadian Congress Journal is praising, this economic relationship, just completely ignoring the context of, one, the current colonialism that was taking place at that time, and then the whole history of slavery, plantation life, etc., that Canada had Canadian capitalists had very much benefited from. The predecessor to the Canadian Labour Congress, both the Trades and Labour Congress and then the Canadian Congress of Labour, they both supported the Korean War in the early 1950s, a war that left millions of people dead. They supported NATO. They actually produced pamphlet to promote NATO. And it wasn't until 1976 that the CLC passed a resolution calling for de-emphasize the role of the North Atlantic Organization. The Canadian Labour Congress supported the U.S. orchestrated invasion of Cuba, the Bay of Pigs invasion. Ed Finn, in his book, he talks about being an editor of a newspaper in Newfoundland that wrote an article critical of the American-backed invasion of Cuba, and the CLC cut all the funding for the newspaper, and that paper actually collapsed because they were the main source of funding. Because they had criticized the American invasion, the CLC supported it. The CLC supported the UN's role in the assassination of Patrice Lumumba, the independence leader in the Congo in the early 1960s. They actually passed a resolution at the UN convention supporting Dag Hagerschmal, the head of the UN, who was the one who was a serious antagonist to Lumumba. And Canada played a very important role in that assassination. At their first convention, the CLC passed a resolution calling for Canada to sell weapons to Israel, and actually calling on Canada to pressure other countries to sell weapons to Israel. My guess is that the CLC has never passed a resolution calling for weapon sales to any other place. And this happened just before Israeli invasion of Egypt with the former colonial powers, France and Britain. Now today, labor movement, I think, has shifted gears on the question of Palestinian rights, in some cases fairly positively. Canadian Union of Postal Workers, most obviously, a number of Quebec unions, QB Ontario, even Unifor have passed boycott, divestment, sanctions resolutions to some extent. So that's changed. I think the final dinosaur of this whole history of anti-Palestinianism within the labor movement was Buzz Hargrove, former head of the Canadian Auto Workers, who was quite staunchly anti-Palestinian, and to the point where he actually went to Israel in 2006, I believe, with Heather Reisman and Jerry Schwartz. Who are the people who played a big part in getting rid of the Canadian Jewish Congress and replacing it with the Canadian Center for Israel and Jewish Affairs, which is just even more of a staunch pro-Israel lobby organization. Now, while I say that the labor movement, for the most part, is now no longer supportive of Canadian imperialism, there is a fairly recent case where that was the case. And that's with regards to the coup in Haiti. in 2004. And Quebec unions, not English Canadian unions, and it's a very interesting question of how that played out, which I'll leave to some other time. But Quebec unions, specifically the FDQ, the main labor federation in Quebec, very much supported the coup and very much supported the aftermath of political repression in Haiti. On February 12th, 2004, about a little bit under 3 weeks before Jean-Bertrand Aristide, the elected president, was overthrown by the French, Americans, Canadian troops, the FDQ put out a statement criticizing Aristide at a time when there was CIA-backed rebels attacking his government. And then the day after Aristide was overthrown, the FDQ put out a press release calling on the international community to, quote, help Haitians build democracy in their country. This is the international community that had just, of course, overthrown democracy in Haiti. So the labor movement, like I said, for the most part, is mostly just indifferent to Canadian foreign policy. Now, that's obviously not acceptable because you can't be neutral on a moving train, right? By not engaging in dealing with Canadian foreign policy, all you're doing is you're allowing the corporations and the foreign affairs establishment to continue with their policies. It doesn't mean that the pro-imperial policies don't happen. You're just leaving, you know, you're leaving it aside, allowing them to get on with their business. But the labor movement, for the most part, isn't actively supportive, unlike the NDP, actively supportive of Canadian imperialism. Now, the third section of the book deals with some left-wing think tanks and some prominent left-wing commentators, people like Linda McQuaig, Stephen Lewis, and then think tanks like the Rideau Institute, a little bit the CCPA, the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives. How many people are familiar with the Rideau Institute? Well, a number of people. So the Rideau Institute is Ottawa-based think tank. People might be familiar with ceasefire.ca. The ceasefire.ca is sort of part of the Rideau Institute. And it's basically the only sort of left-wing foreign policy think tank in this country, mostly focusing on the military side, not really the diplomatic side of Canadian foreign policy. And it does some stuff that I support, some stuff that's fairly good, but it does a lot of stuff, and it's tied into a number of people that put a big question mark over the organization and the limitations of the politics of what it promotes. So, for instance, the head of the Rideau Institute is Peggy Mason. Peggy Mason has had basically a three-decade-long career in official Canadian foreign policy. So back in the 1980s, she was a top advisor to Brian Mulroney's foreign affairs minister, Joe Clark. She was a top advisor to Joe Clark. She's done a series of different positions over the years in official Canadian foreign policy. In 2012, she told the House of Commons Parliamentary Committee that, quote, I'm talking as someone who has spent the better part of the last 10 years working with NATO. Okay? So what she did is she did peacekeeping training for NATO troops. Okay? So the person heading up the main left-wing foreign policy think tank in this country openly talks about how she works with NATO. And according to her LinkedIn profile, that was the case until as of a couple months ago. So that tells you a little bit about the sort of politics of Peggy Mason and the limitations to the Rideau Institute's challenge of Canadian foreign policy. Now, the main person that the Rideau Institute, the work of which they promote, the main individual's work that they promote, is somebody by the name of Walter Dorn. Are people familiar with Walter Dorn? No? Some people? Almost no. Interesting. So Walter Dorn is if there's a story in the Globe and Mail or on CBC about peacekeeping, Walter Dorn is usually quoted. He's the leading proponent of UN peacekeeping in this country. Walter Dorn is also a professor at the Canadian Forces College and at the Royal Military College both of which are military-run institutions. He runs the chair of Masters of Defense Studies at the Royal Military College. He's been a consultant for UN Department of Peacekeeping Operations, including in Haiti, in the years after the coup. Now, the coup in 2004 became a UN mission, right? It became a UN force. Canadian troops actually just became part of a UN mission. And so Walter Dorn did work in Haiti, was a consultant in Haiti, and has written a whole bunch about that period of time in Haiti, in the UN mission in Haiti, totally ignoring the UN's role of, first of all, supporting the coup, secondly, directly engaging in violent repression against the neighborhoods that were seen as supportive of the elected president, and also providing, and the UN force also provided a whole lot of support to the Haitian police that were killing, firing on unarmed demonstrators calling for the return of democracy. Now that's completely absent from Walter Dorn's writing about Haiti, and he's a proponent, he criticizes those who criticize the UN mission in Haiti, and he was a proponent of Canada increasing its role in UN mission in Haiti, telling CBC in 2011, a number of years after the soldiers, Canada's soldiers in the UN mission had been removed, he told the CBC that the world is, quote, crying for Canada to expand its role in UN missions, saying, we have long-standing police contribution in Haiti, but we could easily contribute to the military side. So prodding Canada to increase its military involvement in the UN mission in Haiti. Now, looking back at Walter Dorn's writing on other UN missions that Canada was part of, he's entirely supportive. Okay, so for the UN mission in the early 1960s that played a role in the assassination of Patrice Lumumba, where Canadian forces played a central role in Lumumba's assassination, Walter Dorn completely ignores the UN's role in Lumumba's assassination. Similarly, Walter Dorn's supportive of the UN mission in Korea. Right? The Korean War was actually a UN mission. It led to as many as 4 million people being killed, but it was a UN a police action. This is Walter Dorn writing about the UN, Canada's military role in Korea. He said, quote, Canada sent a large contingent of troops to Korea in 1950 to fight in a UN police action to protect the elected South Korean government. That is an incredible distortion of the history, right? Lee's government had killed tens of thousands of leftists in the lead up to what we call the Korean War. The Americans had used the UN very clearly to divide the country, to strengthen their position, et cetera, et cetera. But for Walter Dorn, ipso facto, if it's a UN mission, it's positive. Right? And he'll rewrite the history of UN missions that Canada's part of to portray them positively. And so that's the main individual that the Rideau Institute, or central figure that the Rideau Institute had done a number of reports with Walter Dorn, public events in Ottawa with Walter Dorn, et cetera, et cetera. At the commentator level, like I mentioned, I have a section that deals with Linda McQuaig and Linda McQuaig's mythology around Lester Pearson, specifically. Maybe more substantively, there's a section dealing with Stephen Lewis. I'm sure that everyone in the room is familiar with Stephen Lewis. He's the great savior of Africa in Canada. And I got going on Stephen Lewis stuff on a night bus ride during the launch of my Canada and Africa 300 Years of Aid and Exploitation book in 2015. I came across an article quoting Stephen Lewis on a bus ride between Lethbridge and Nelson. Long ride, and then I then spent the rest of the evening looking into Stephen Lewis's role in writings about Africa. And in this article, Stephen Lewis, this is during the election campaign of 2015. It's an article basically where Stephen Lewis is complaining or criticizing the Harper government role in Africa, saying that they hadn't done enough. The Harper government hadn't done enough in Africa. Well, I was on a book tour with one of the messages I was putting forward was the fact that the Harper government had fully oriented Canadian policy on the continent to serving the interests of Canadian mining. $30 billion in Canadian mining investment on the continent.
biggest, can it come as being the biggest players basically everywhere on the continent with the exception of South Africa. And aid policy, diplomacy, signing foreign investment promotion protection agreements with African countries, all of this was being done to advance the interests of Canadian mining companies that were sucking out and are sucking out billions of dollars, probably annually, in profits from the continent. All kinds of examples of not paying their taxes, corruption, on and on and on. You just example of killings, mining companies killing people, on and on and on. But here you have Stephen Lewis complaining Canada's not doing enough in Africa. Additionally, Harper, the war in Libya had led to not only destabilizing that country, but the whole Sahel region of the continent. Harper government's climate policy was a death sentence for more and more Africans. None of that in Stephen Lewis's. We need to do more. We need to just do more in Africa. And so when researching Stephen Lewis's writing and speaking about the continent, you find that I actually didn't find any criticisms except for Canada not doing more. I didn't. They may be out there, but I didn't find them. And so this is just a complete whitewashing of a whole history. Nothing about Canada's, the Canadians who helped conquer the continent, late 1800s. There's Canadians, hundreds of Canadians that fought all across the continent, helped the British conquer, helped the Belgian king conquer a big chunk of the Congo. The Canadians who were colonial governors. Canadian who was a British governor of northern Nigeria, of Kenya, of Ghana. Nothing about the program that had students from McGill, U of T, Queens in the 1920s put right into the British colonial service so they could be colonial officers across the continent. Nothing about the 1.3 billion, about 8 billion in today's money, of weaponry that Canada delivered to the NATO powers, European powers, after World War II in the 1950s, while France had 400,000 troops in Algeria. Canada was delivering bullets to the French as they were shooting the Algerian independence, sending weaponry to the British as they were repressing the so-called Mau Mau revolt in Kenya, sending weaponry to the Belgians as they're repressing independence struggle in the Congo. That's not part of Stephen Lewis' description of Canada's role in Africa. The tens, probably hundreds of millions of dollars of Canadian aid money that supported structural adjustment programs all across the continent. Right? I'm talking about there's direct money, probably at least 100 million in direct Canadian aid, as well as hundreds of millions via the IMF and the World Bank, and Canada being a big proponent of the IMF and World Bank, pushing structural adjustment programs. Structural adjustment programs being programs that open up countries' economies to foreign corporations, to pushing governments to reduce spending on social services, et cetera, et cetera. Now, in Stephen Lewis's book, Race Against Time, he does criticize structural adjustment programs, but Canada is not part of that criticism. Canada didn't engage in this. Lo and behold, Stephen Lewis, of course, was Brian Mulroney's ambassador to the UN, and Brian Mulroney was the individual, the government that began Canada's push for structural adjustment programs in Africa. So it was effectively his government that Stephen Lewis was part of that was pushing these programs. So it's maybe not a coincidence that he wouldn't have criticized Canada's role in this endeavor. So when you look at Stephen Lewis's role in his speaking and his writing about Canada's role in Africa, it's amazing that all of this history is ignored and it's just about Canada doing more. Now, I think it's quite informative, at least people who are a bit older, some people in this room probably, who have a bit of a history and knowledge of Stephen Lewis's domestic policies. Someone like my dad, for instance, who has a sort of hostility to Stephen Lewis, or views Stephen Lewis as being a right-wing NDPer, because Stephen Lewis, of course, was the individual who played the biggest role in ousting the waffle from the NDP in the early 1970s. Right? He was somebody viewed as very repressive, the waffle being a sort of left-wing current that got about almost 40% of the vote in the NDP election. Stephen Lewis is the individual who played the biggest role in ousting the waffle. And if you look online, there's actually lots of criticism, lots and lots of criticism of Stephen Lewis's role with regards to the waffle. Now, as Stephen Lewis moves from the domestic sphere domestic sphere to international realm. Brian Mulroney is ambassador to UN, UNICEF, a whole series of other international positions, and you know, Stephen Lewis Foundation, that kind of stuff. The criticism dries up. Now, I actually think I have more agreement with Stephen Lewis's policies domestically than I do with his foreign policies. But what exists when it comes to a politician conceding on domestic issues, we have a culture of challenging those commentators, of challenging those politicians, right? Of criticizing them if we feel like they're too right-wing. But we don't have that culture on international affairs. And we particularly don't have that culture on the weakest places, i.e. Africa being, many African countries being among the weakest parts of the world. So somebody who just calls for more charity, right? Somebody who just says, I want to build a bunch of private health system, private schools, something that we would never agree with here, right? NGO schools, I mean, we would never agree with that. We believe in public schools. We believe in public education. The left believes in public schools and public education. But the model of charity that we're pushing in Africa is one that we would not accept here. In fact, part of the democratic process that's taken place was, you know, taking schools from being run by churches to being publicly run and whatnot. But any push for charity in Africa or any criticism of geopolitical, Canada's geopolitical competitors, you'll find that Stephen Lewis is very comfortable criticizing China or Zimbabwe very aggressively. You find he has no problem being very critical. It just has a problem being very critical of Canada. But we were willing to laud somebody when they're supporting charity and criticizing geopolitical competitors when it's in Africa. But yet, on domestic issues, there's a bit more of a culture of holding politicians, holding commentators to account. Now, the question becomes the why, right? Why are the left institutions, left commentators, conceding so much to the dominant narrative of Canadian foreign policy? Now, with regards to commentators, I think it's part of it is fairly straightforward in that you can't survive in the Toronto Star or in the CBC and by saying, you know, for instance, the world needs less Canada, right? Linda McQuaig, who reflects the best end of the corporate media commentators, columnists, she could probably write one time that the world needs less Canada, but if that became a constant theme of her columns, the Toronto Star would almost certainly say, bye-bye, Linda. Even though, with regards to foreign policy, the facts are overwhelming that the world needs less Canada, of course, right? But the debate in the dominant media is so narrow on foreign policy questions that you just can't say something like that and expect to survive. So I think some elements of this come down to this simple, personal kind of career stuff. Broader, I look at a whole series of different connections between, for instance, the NDP and the foreign affairs establishment. So Hélène Lavardière, the NDP foreign critic, she worked at foreign affairs for 15 years before running for the NDP. She won an award for Canadian foreign policy, right? So her background is fairly, illustrates, you know, how far she may be willing to go in terms of criticizing Canadian foreign policy. And there's a whole bunch of ways in which NDP MPs are drawn into the foreign affairs orbit. Things like the Canadian Forces Parliamentary Program, where the military takes MPs and brings them on boats, Canadian gunboats, or on army bases, and sort of tries to influence them. There's different parliamentary associations in Ottawa that do, I think, some of the same thing in terms of they very much reinforce, they're totally skewed towards Europe, which reinforces power imbalances in the world. There's the all-expense-paid trips that MPs go, different lobby groups bring MPs on, the most obvious example being the Israel lobby groups that one estimate in 2014 said that 20 NDP MPs had been on all-expense-paid trips to Israel with CEJA. So there's a whole series of ways in which MPs get sucked into the foreign affairs orbit. Same thing with the with unions, the Canadian Labour Congress. I detail a whole bunch of ties between, this goes back to the post-World War II period, of labour officials being tied into external affairs. Most of the funding for the Canadian Labour Congress's international affairs comes from Canada's aid agency, right? So that obviously is going to constrain your ability to challenge, criticize Canadian foreign policy. And the CLC has all kinds of links to Canadian government-backed foreign policy-focused institutions in Ottawa. One that's, I think, an important one that shapes their political outlook on Canada's foreign policy is their relationship to the Canadian Council for International Cooperation. The Canadian Council for International Cooperation being the main NGO umbrella group in Ottawa. The CCIC was set up in the late 1960s with funding from CETA, from the Canadian Aid Agency. And the CLC has had a position on the CCIC's board for most of the last half century, or a different time. Right now, they're not actually on the board. It's the steel workers that are. the CCIC, just to give you a sense of the politics of the CCIC, they held a Congress convention in Ottawa last month. And this is what the part of their promotion material said, quote, "Inspired by Justin Trudeau's 2015 proclamation, Canada is back, we are presenting panels that illustrate or challenge Canada's role in global leadership. Are we doing all that we could be doing in the world?" Right? Again, more of this, like, more Canada. Nothing about the arms sales to the Saudi monarchy, nothing about the anti-Palestinian votes at the UN, nothing about trying to destabilize Venezuela's government, nothing about opposing nuclear arms control measures, nothing about Canadian deployments, military deployments on Russia's border, nothing about increasing military spending, right? It's all this more kind of more Canada. That's the perspective the CCIC is pushing. And the Canadian Labour Congress is tied in to that Ottawa milieu of NGOs, different sort of, they're not tied into the right wing, the hard right wing militarist foreign policy milieu. They're tied into the sort of liberal, small L, aid agency kind of milieu. Now, probably the most important element in terms of explaining why the left has conceded to the dominant narrative is the question of nationalism. In the book, I do have a section dealing with Quebecois nationalism, dealing how that's the sort of foreign policy compromises of Quebecois nationalism. And I also have a section dealing with how First Nations leadership have bought into Canadian foreign policy nationalism. So the biggest victims of the Canadian state have often upheld Canadian foreign policy nationalism. But the main nationalism that I'll deal with, and I think the most important, is this sort of left nationalist, English Canada, left nationalist kind of perspective. And it's really extreme. It's really strong, right? And it's underpinning this sort of, this nationalism, this benevolent Canada is a very important part of this ideology, right? This idea of Canadian exceptionalism. Its basis is really that Canada is this force for good in the world. Peacekeeping is a really important part of this. And you'll find that even when politicians or commentators from the left are criticizing Canadian wars, they do it in a way to uphold this mythology of benevolent Canada. Specifically, I'm talking about a couple examples with regards to Afghanistan. This is Jack Layton in 2006 opposing Canada's role in Afghanistan. He said, quote, "New Democrats have not written a blank check so that this government can drag Canada still farther into war so that it can remove us farther from our role as international peacekeepers." So his criticism of Canada's role in Afghanistan is that it was moving us away from our tradition of being international peacekeepers. Or here's Walter Dorn doing it in an even more crass kind of way, crude way. Walter Dorn says, quote, "The first consequence of our current deployment in Afghanistan is that Canada is currently at a historic low in its UN peacekeeping contribution." I thought the first consequence of Canada's military engagement in Afghanistan was that we were occupying Afghanistan, not that we couldn't be involved in some other moral crusade, right? But his criticism is that this is undermining our possibility of some other moral crusade. And of course, it was Darfur was one of the ones that they suggest. He actually suggested Haiti. He even suggested Haiti as another moral crusade we could be part of. So this nationalism, the peacekeeping mythology is very powerful. In their book Warrior Nation, Ian McKay and Jamie Swift talk a bit about this, the centrality of peacekeeping to nationalist ideology. He says the Ottawa Min, referring to the Pearson kind of Lester Pearson kind of world in the 1950s, diplomats, the Ottawa Min developed a nationalist myth symbol complex about an imagined community outside Canada in which Canadians played an indispensable, indeed world-reshaping role, placing them at the heart of the great crusade for peace and democracy, right? I think that ideology is very powerful in Canada in general and on the left in particular. Part of the nationalist myth, left nationalist myth, is the idea of Canada as a colony. The British and then as colony of the US, which is the more important one, but starting with the British one. So while technically correct that Canada was a colony of Britain, Canada was not a colony of Britain like Kenya was a colony of Britain, right? The British, French, other European settlers weren't dispossessed of their land in current day Canada. They dispossessed Indigenous people, which is self-evident. Unlike the Kikuyu in Kenya, who were actually dispossessed of their land by the British. And Canada was, at the time of Confederation, a big part of it was about extending the British Empire westward, right? Building the railway, setting up a naval base on Vancouver Island, that was about extending British power to Asia, right? So the idea of Canada as a colony is a real problem. Now, more specifically, in current times, of Canada as a colony of Britain, or sorry, of the U.S., is also a really important part of left nationalism that has leads to serious problems in understanding Canadian foreign policy. So the WAFL, the leftist, nationalist leftist, what was called the Movement for an Independent Socialist Canada, their manifesto in the early 1970s, their manifesto referred to Canada as a reduction of Canada to a colony of the United States. Or Bruce Campbell, the founder of the Canadian Center for Policy Alternatives in 2014, he referred to Canada as a colonial supplicant, right? Canada being dominated by the U.S. And like Haiti, right? Canada dominated by the U.S. like Haiti is, right? Was Canada occupied for 20 years by the U.S. And then had militarily occupied and then had its treasury controlled for another 13 or 14 years by the U.S.? Did American troops march into Ottawa, take the National Reserve and march back across the border like they did in Port-au-Prince? Of course not, right? And most of the countries of the hemisphere were colonized or dominated and are dominated by the U.S. at an infinitely greater rate than Canada is. So the idea of Canada as being a colony of the U.S. is a serious problem. It masks Canada's real position in global capitalist affairs. So part of this, the left nationalist ideology, has that the Canada is the staple trap, right? That Canada produces commodities. It's got a weak manufacturing center. It's a weak manufacturing hub, and American corporations dominate. And the Paul Kellogg, in his book Staple Trap, Canada After Left Nationalism, Escape from the Staple Trap. Sorry. Paul Kellogg writes in discussing putting the staple trap into global perspective, he says, quote, Though, and the staple trap is dominant in Canadian political economy, left political economy. It's he argues, and I believe he's correct, it's been dominant for the past couple of decades. And Kellogg writes, quote, "Those who apply the simple staple trap analogy to Canada almost always fail to interrogate the analogy from the standpoint of Canada's hugely privileged place in the world economy. A world economy that is extremely hierarchical," right? Five of the world's 60 biggest banks are based in Canada, right? Canada's 0.5% of the world's population. That's tens of times Canada's population. Half of the world's mining companies are based in Canada, 0.5% of them, 100 times Canada's proportion of the world. One of the biggest engineering companies in the world, SNC-Lavalin in Montreal. Biggest privately held private security company, Garda World in Montreal. On and on and on. Canada is not at the periphery of global capitalism. Canada is at the center of global capitalism, right? And left nationalism ignores that. It also ignores the history of Canadian corporate interests being direct beneficiaries of American imperialism. So when the Americans took control of Cuba in the late 1800s, a time before American banks had restrictions on their international affairs, the main beneficiary in the banking sector was the Royal Bank. It became the biggest bank in Cuba. Right? The Americans, that was their preferred client, was the Royal Bank, the preferred banking operator. Similarly, in the Philippines, the Canadian elite see the world and profit from the world in a very similar way to the U.S. elite. I would suggest that rather than this idea of Canada as a colony, we should think of Canada as having had very close relationship to the two main empires of the past couple centuries, and Canada going from an appendage of the imperial center, Britain, to an appendage of the imperial center, the U.S. And left nationalist ideology makes it hard to see that. Now, what do we do about this? I think that we need to build internationalism, of course, and we need to build internationalism. I mean, the climate question is one that can't be dealt with without real internationalism. So there's all kinds of moral reasons for why we need to build internationalism, besides the climate question. But I think that adds a whole other layer. Now, how to build that is obviously tricky. It's not easy, and there's lots of what the Peace Alliance is doing here. Is part of what we need to be doing is a whole lot more of that, right? Rebuilding the anti-war movement, strengthening that, building the Palestine solidarity movements, building the Latin American solidarity movements, mining injustice work. All that is central to what needs to be done. Now, there's no one answer to foreign policy questions. Part of the problem with foreign policy is that because it's so far removed from our day-to-day lives, it's hard to get a grasp of exactly what's going on. We don't know much about Syria. We don't know much about Afghanistan, Haiti, whatever. We don't have much personal connection to those places, so it's very difficult can be difficult to get a sense of exactly what's going on. So there's no sort of like blanket principle of what should be done on foreign policy. Each issue and topic is, you need to know the facts, and each one is specific. There are some general principles that I put forward in this book and previous books about what a just foreign policy is or what a left-wing foreign policy should be. Obviously, the golden rule is not a bad place to start. Do unto others as you would have done unto yourself. So if you don't like the idea of your country being bombed by other countries, well. In this book, I put forward another principle of should be part of left foreign policy, which first do no harm. taking from the medical world. If we would have been operating on a first do no harm basis, or if the first do no harm crowd would have won out over the interventionists in 2011 with regards to Libya, Libya would be better off today, I think, and much of the Sahel region of Africa would be better off. Fortunately, the first do no harm principle is actually based in international law. Self-determination is a part of the UN Charter. The supreme international crime is aggression without UN approval. I think that we'd be do well to think about the first do no harm principle. And that goes very much against Canadian foreign policy across the political, spanning the political spectrum, right? The NGO crowd is calling for more aid for Canada to do more in the world that way. The hard militarists are calling for just to, bomb, bomb, bomb. And then the UN peacekeeping crowd is, let's call for a responsibility to protect UN peacekeeping. So across the political spectrum, there's this do more Canadian foreign policy kind of line. So first do harm is actually somewhat of a revolutionary idea in Canadian foreign policy, but I think it's one that needs to be certainly put on the discussion table. Like I said, it's complicated. Foreign policy questions are complicated. There's no easy answer to most of these questions. But the work of it's the activist work that we need to I think amplify, because many of these questions are pretty straightforward, or important parts of the questions are pretty straightforward. And so it's more of the activism that is currently taking place. It's massively expanding, and I think that's essential what needs to be done. In the book, I do suggest the establishment of the Canadian Foreign Policy Institute, a left-wing think tank that engages all elements of Canadian foreign policy, challenges all elements of Canadian foreign policy. The website's already live, foreignpolicy.ca. In its initial phase, it's just a repository of critical information on Canadian foreign policy. It has a list of the best books on Canadian foreign policy, has dozens, hundreds of articles critical of different elements of Canadian foreign policy. With time, we hope to have like a speakers bureau of people who are sort of experts in different domains of the world or elements of Canadian foreign policy to offer a place for either media or groups or whatever to invite speakers, whatnot. And the sky's the limit in terms of where this could go, set up chapters in different cities across the country, et cetera, et cetera. Do the work of producing reports like think tanks do. And the idea would be to bring together, intellectually at least, amplify a lot of the good activism that's going on, but also to bring together in a more whole challenge of Canadian foreign policy. So to conclude, there is no easy answer to these questions, but it's imperative that we hold our politicians, our unions, our institutions to task to uphold internationalism, to not contribute to making the life of people who in many parts of the world are living in very difficult circumstances even more difficult. I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much.